Beyond the Waves is a Hail Hail Media production. It may contain sweary words, and adult situations may be discussed. If you're in the company of underage temps, turn off the show now and listen back later. If you'd like to get in touch with the show, email us at beyondthewaves67@gmail.com. You can also find us on Twitter at BTW Celtic Show, or you can join our group on Facebook at Beyond the Waves. Hail Hail, and keep the faith.
By Irish hands, searching for a new homeland. Scotty Scottish, Irish, American. I'll see you there on St. Patrick's Day. The stars and the stripes, the green and the white, united together along the avenue. The snow and the cold, the young and the old, the brave and the bold, here's what we're going. We'll dance all day and we'll drink the night away. First New York City on St. Patrick's Day. The ticker tape falls from the sky. We sing the fields of Athenry. It's a pilgrimage that will never die. I'll see you there on St. Patrick's Day. Empire State's a sight to see. It's lit up bright in emerald green. And this is where I wanna be. NYC, it's St. Patrick's Day. Stars and the stripes, the green and the white, united together along the avenue. The snow and the cold, the young and the old, the brave and the bold, here's what we're doing. All day, I won't drink the night away. First New York City, on St. Patrick's Day. We're gonna celebrate a St. Patty's Day parade in the city that never sleeps, in the land of liberty. And we'll sing and we'll dance all day. I won't drink the night away, for it's New York City on St. Patrick's Day.
Welcome to the Beyond the Wave Celtic Football Show. My name is Graham Wilson. Sorry for the delay there. Had a little bit of an issue with Spreaker, but I hopefully have it sorted now. And we have a great show today. Thank you for tuning in. Joining us in about 20 minutes' time is Collins Okinyo, all the way from, he's originally from Kenya. He's actually in Zambia at the moment covering the African Champions League. So I want to get his thoughts in terms of the situation at the moment with Victor Wanyama as well as Efe Ambrose. A lot of speculation about Victor Wanyama's future and as it pertains specifically to Celtic. So I want to get his feedback. He's written some great, great articles recently for republicfootball.net. Eugene's fantastic website, and he has a particular insight into this issue that I want to get, and I think is particularly useful for us all, free of the NUCO bias, you know, and agenda that is just permeating through the coverage of Celtic. Nothing new there, but it's going to be fantastic. I've been looking forward to talking to him for quite some time, and it's going to be fantastic. Also want to thank again Jim from the Celtic Graves Society for joining me last week. That was just an absolutely phenomenal show, probably one of the best we've had. And if you haven't had a chance to take a listen, I mean, obviously after we come off of, you know, just one of these gutting performances, sometimes the last thing you want to do is continue on and listen in to me rant. But he really switched things around. I mean, I went off for about 30 minutes and it looked like today's game was going to send me into something quite similar, but that was not to be. But if you can get through the first 30 minutes of last week's show and you haven't listened to it yet, please do, because Jim was absolutely fantastic talking about their event coming up on April 6th and really lifted my spirits and everybody who had listened in. So thanks again to him and to everybody who had such great feedback on that. But what a result today and what a performance. Well, I mean, coming into the last 20 minutes of the game, you know, and as I sort of alluded to, it did look like this was going to be another one of those games where we get the early goal. We get, you know, we have this template now. You know, it's almost a pattern. We get a quick goal or an early goal, and then we just sort of slink back into the game, and we don't chase after it. We don't continue chasing after it, and we saw a lot of that. Went 2-1 down, and then, of course, 3-1 down from some just absolutely ropey defending. Kelvin Wilson, you know, he's got a man running right across him and decides too late that he's going to actually go and chase after him and leave Fraser Forster completely exposed. I think Forster probably could have done much better with that second goal there, but you know, he hasn't quite been the same since he's returned from injury. You know, and that's to be expected. We've said that. But certainly we need to be expecting more of this. We need to expect some of these just standard saves that really need to be made. But the second goal and for a large portion of the third goal was really set up not by one particular individual, but by the breakdown completely of the team. Once again, we see Charlie Mulgrew playing through the midfield, and I'm not sure, other than set pieces, what he would provide, what he would offer in the midfield, especially going up against a team like Aberdeen, especially when you have a player like Rojek or Dylan McGeoch who are on the bench and offer something drastically different and, in my opinion, much better in terms of attack, in terms of linking up play. For me, Charlie Mulgrew is not adept enough to play in the midfield, and I mean, he doesn't have the pace to get by a player, so that's for starters. But a lot of his 5-yard passes, I mean, play the ball in front of the man. So many times we get the run of play and the pass is behind the player, so it immediately slows things down. It breaks up the rhythm of any sort of advance, and he just waits passes completely incorrectly. I mean, you know, 5-yard pass and just rockets it right in there. And when you have players who are dealing with or struggling with, you know, a lack of first touch, if you will, that can set up some problems there for sure. But anyway, you know, we saw it through, you know, fortunately, and you know, we saw a lot of that. You know, we've gotten sort of accustomed to some sloppy forward play. I mean, in our forwards today, Hooper, Anthony Stokes, statues. Once again, we need to make those advancing runs, offer some outlets for our forward players so that, you know, we can you know, spring on from there. But at any rate, I'm still dealing with some technical issues, and I just want to check on one thing really quick. So we're going to take a quick break. I'm going to play a song, which I think is appropriate for the day, for the weekend. Happy St. Patrick's Day to everyone. And hopefully I can get this sorted out. And as I mentioned, we can have Collins Aquino joining us here in just a few minutes. But let me see if I can get this song queued up here. Okay, this is bad. Okay. And I'm not even sure if the sound is coming through clearly. So if somebody can check and let me know, and you know, I can make sure that that's happening. You do as much as you can to try and prepare for this sort of thing, and sometimes it goes pear-shaped. But nonetheless, also want to give a shout-out to the Green Brigade. You know, obviously, some shocking scenes in the beginning of the game, or I guess before the game even started. You know, the Green Brigade had assembled, and you know, here again, we come into, you know, these varying and very liberal definitions of what is actually taking place. You know, apparently, if you meet in a pub and organize so that you can have an organized walk up to the stadium, that defines in and of itself a demonstration and therefore requiring a permit. And once again, we saw some heavy-handed police actions that were inflammatory, to say the least, harassing and police brutality in a textbook definition. And it just continues. And, you know, the media in Scotland obviously is going to stand idly by and watch this. And some good work done by Chris Chiava, as well as others who documented this as it took place with pictures. You know, we saw shocking scenes of, you know, kettling is the technical term for what the police were doing, of you know, about 75 to 100 Celtic supporters and taking names and making arrests for what I have no idea whatsoever. But it's shocking. And, you know, how anybody can continue to not stand by and support the Green Brigade is beyond me. I mean, all they are Celtic supporters who are trying to create some atmosphere. They have banners, they sing songs, and therefore they are criminals in the eyes of so many. And it's just absolutely shocking. And we need to all stand up and support the Green Brigade. And the silence is deafening coming out of Celtic Park right now. The club itself need to do something about this. Their own supporters, and as they view us, their own customers are being harassed. And it's just unacceptable. I mean, they are threatening Celtic's ability to continue in business, and there's absolutely no merit for it. It's harassment at the very crux of the definition, and it's reached a perilous episode. Stay with us. I'm going to play a quick song and see if I can figure this out, and we'll be right back.
Lord, won't you give me the strength to be strong and be true? So mighty, why waste your time with me? If I'm bad, ignorant and sad, why waste your time? You're mad. You're just mad because your life is sad. You've done nothing worthwhile. Twist a knife because you hate your life. My life you want to spoil. I never will forget the suffering that my people wear. cynic hill. Jesus, wake up and live. Your bad vibe will drive away your tribe. And where will you be then? All alone, heart that's cold as stone, hurting yourself again.
Listen to Beyond the Wave Celtic Football Show. My name is Graham Wilson. I think I have these laptop issues sorted out, so fantastic stuff with that. 4-3 victory today, 3-1 down with about 20 minutes to go. And, you know, I mean, my heart's going, you know, 180 beats per minute. I'm hyperventilating, as I typically do. It's probably not hard for anybody to imagine if you've listened to this show for any extended period, but it had all the familiar rings, except this time, it was Aberdeen that was just, for me, looking like they chucked it. I mean, giving away possession quite easily and carelessly. And this time we were up to the task in terms of taking advantage of some slack play. I mean, it, obviously when Samaras came on, it completely changed the complexion of the game. For me, I would have liked to have seen Neil Lennon making some substitutions a lot earlier and making a couple of substitutions because, I mean, it was completely obvious at halftime that the setup that we were going out with was ineffective. It wasn't having any sort of impact, and actually it was ceding control of the game, and didn't look like it was having any sort of hope or prospect that it was going to come around. When Samaras came on, I think it changed things a lot, and then certainly when Lassad came on, I think Anthony Stokes really, for me, really let himself down. I mean, for a player who's playing for a contract, I expected a lot more out of him. He had some opportunities, a couple of just open looks on the keeper, and just wasted. A lot of that link-up play was just very slack. First touches, five-yard passing once again, and just some of the ideas were just completely lacking. And all of that completely changed at the 70th minute. I mean, we started sending wave after wave balls into the box, and we had players who were there, and they looked like they gave a damn. They looked like they were hungry. They looked like they wanted to win this game. That's the first time I've really seen that in probably over a month, with the St. Mirren game probably as the exception. I really feel like in a lot of ways we hung on to win that game. It was ropey to a large extent throughout that game as well. But we saw players who wanted to fight, who were desperate not just to level the game, but to get that 3 points, to get the winner. And for me, Samaras, the performance that he put in, yes, you know, he had some atrocious first touches and lost the ball carelessly in several situations. And we know we can expect that from him, but he was exactly where he needed to be when it counted. And for me, F.A. Ambrose has come under a lot of criticism as of late, with good reason in a lot of situations. But for me, he really set up the last two goals, no question about it. I mean, his presence in the box, heading the ball on the frame, and then setting up opportunities for the fellow players, you know, some of the forwards. I mean, obviously, Gary Hooper put that goal away, and then really, I mean, just setting up Georgios Samaras with another fantastic overhead kick. I mean, from a player like Samaras, it's very impressive technical ability and the celebration. I mean, you know, Lustig goes running after him, and I mean, he just bounces off of him, goes flying. It's like Sammy's a superhero. He takes the jersey, obviously. I don't need any stinking jersey. Somebody give me some head and shoulders. But it was fantastic stuff. I lost my voice a little bit. Maybe you can tell that, but just a great feeling. I mean, obviously, it was not a thing of beauty today. Let's be honest with that. There were up until about, you know, the 70th to the 75th minute, you know, it continued on some of that bad form that we've had over the past several weeks, and we turned it on. And you know, it's moments like this. I mean, think back to the Kilmarnock game last October, you know, where that really kicked on the push, as it were, to close that 15-point gap at the time with the now deceased Rangers. And I firmly believe and I hope that this opportunity today, this situation, is going to do the same in the run-in for, you know, hopefully getting a couple of pieces of silverware. It's these are the type of character-building performances that really spring on certain players and really start to foster some belief amongst each other. But there are some slack parts of the team just now that really need to be worked on at Lennoxtown. I mean, some of the play that I was seeing today in that first half, in the early part of the second half, it makes me wonder what is going on at Lennoxtown with some of the passing, not just in terms of the weight. I mean, that was lacking. But positioning, play the ball in front of the player. You know, too many passes are behind. Lassad, for me, again, I have to echo my previous thoughts. He's not strong enough, you know, to play back to goal. I mean, several opportunities today, back to goal, pushed off the ball far too easily, dispossessed. Very similar to Sammy. I mean, they look very similar. They play in a very similar way. And I think it speaks to the fact that Sammy, I think, would be an absolute dynamo if he went to a place like La Liga or even Serie A. But he pushes through, and another fantastic performance, winning the game for us today, 4-3. I mean, it was absolutely essential that we got the 3 points, and to do it in such a way was enthralling. I mean, you know, the whole way home in the car, I mean, I was just, you know, screaming. So it's a good day. No rants. You know, obviously we're interested in results and correct the errors, but let's really embrace this performance today in how we played and the fight that we exemplified and that we exhibited, that's really been lacking over the past several weeks, you know, where it seemed as though we were holding on, trying to, you know, protect a lead or protect a draw even. You know, we really got after it, and I can't be more delighted with it. So fantastic stuff. Let's see if we can get Collins on. I, like I said, Collins Okinyo, Kenyan journalist who at the moment is in Zambia, and he's covering the African Champions League, but he's written some fantastic pieces as of late in terms of the future of Victor Wanyama. So I want to get his thoughts, and I think it's going to be absolutely fantastic listening. So let's see if we can get him. This will be our first guest joining us from Africa. So, hello.
Hello.
Hey, Collins, how you doing?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us today, pal. Really look forward to this for quite some time. So, I've been a fan of your work, and especially, you know, what you've written over the past several weeks, I think has injected some levity and some higher thinking in terms of the analysis of Victor Wanyama, F.A. Ambrose, their impact on Celtic, and also their future prospects. I mean, they have big things, especially Victor in the short term. They have big things in front of them, you know, considering what they've done at Celtic in the Champions League against the best teams in the world. And it's always good to get some clear thinking, and like I said, some high-minded thinking from a great source like yourself. So we thank you so much for joining us. Now, specifically, your article this week, you know, it talked about the prospect of Victor Wanyama leaving. I'm talking about in republicfootball.net. You can find it there. But you talked about the prospect of Wanyama leaving Celtic in the summer transfer window. Much has been made of that in the mainstream media and elsewhere. There's a lot of speculation. Manchester United, obviously Arsenal, there are a lot of rumors going about just now. But it's not such a sure thing for Victor, you know, to go straight into an EPL side like Manchester United or Arsenal and continue that same career trajectory that he's had at Celtic, is it?
Yes, that's true. To be sincere, these issues about Victor moving, there have been so much on the player. And I remember 2 months ago when I was speaking to him, it has really, really affected him because he felt like there's too much talking about his moving and no one was concentrating about his career. But the truth of the matter is that not everything can ever go right. And the best example is for his brother, McDonald Mariga. When he was at Parma, he was one of the best players. Then shortly in 2011, in the last day of the transfer window, he was signed by Jose Mourinho, but when he went to Inter Milan, it was very good playing time. So this is a very good example for him because Mariga has been and has been. The players have got agents, but some of these agents, some of them are there to make the money. Yes, we believe the players want to go up, but I believe Victor Wanyama still needs like one season to play hard or 2 seasons to mature very, you know, properly at Celtic. Then he might think of that move, or else he might turn out to be another player who goes to Manchester United. All of a sudden, the career is finished.
Yeah, exactly. That's an important point. I mean, that's something that Victor needs to be aware of. You know, it's not just about going to a big club just to be there, just to collect the money. It's also about, you know, what sort of impact you're going to have, what sort of ability or opportunity you're going to have to go there. You know, you don't want to go someplace and then sit on the bench or maybe, you know, not be ready yet. You know, I mean, the EPL especially is a very unforgiving place where one bad game can see you drop to the bench, and 2 bad games, I mean, and that can see you training with the youth team. And that's something that, you know, you really want to be ready for going into it. And I'm not so sure if Victor is quite there yet. You know, let's be honest. I mean, he's had some absolutely outstanding performances in the Champions League as well as in the SPL. But, you know, he still is a young player. He's still learning his craft. And there are still certain aspects to his game that you know, I think could do with some polishing. And plus, you know, he still has opportunities to play on the biggest stages with Celtic, such as qualifying for Champions League. And we've seen the product of that this past season. And you bring up a good example with his brother, McDonald Mariga, you know, who had a lot of prospects in front of him. Like you mentioned, Jose Mourinho brought him in the January transfer window just a few years back, and, you know, from Parma. And it just never seemed to click for him. He had some injury troubles, went out on loan a couple times. Now he finds himself back at Parma. And this is a good case study. I think this is an apt analogy that you bring up. You talk a lot about the guidance that Victor's brother has offered him. They seem like they're pretty close. I mean, I've seen McDonald Mariga turn up to watch Victor play in some SPL games when McDonald Mariga himself was nursing some injuries. They seem like they're pretty close. I mean, how would you describe their relationship? I mean, are they competitive with each other? Are they really supportive?
To be sincere, you know, McDonald Mariga is the elder brother of Victor Wanyama. Before Victor moved to this big, wherever he is right now, going through Celtic, Wanyama, McDonald Mariga played a big part in his move to Belgium because he had contacts there. You know, the days when he was playing for Helsingborg, he had a lot of contacts. So he's been looking up to him as that big brother that can talk to me about, you know, my career, because he's been there at the top. Victor, as you said, is a player who's maturing, and to be maturing, you need to take time, because there's one moment where everyone might be talking very great things about you, but the next time, you know, things might be different. So personally, McDonald Mariga is a very calm guy, and I know they're not competitive in any way, but they depend on each other for guidance. I remember there's a time I always do things on my Facebook, so I had an argument about Mariga, then some people really talked badly. That day, Victor called me. Victor was very annoyed, calling, why are these guys talking about this thing? But I personally made sure that I had another article on the same Facebook telling guys, but look, this McDonald Mariga is a great Kenyan player, and we should not be dissing him with all these words. And by the end of the day, Victor was happy. That one showed me that he really looks up to his brother, and anything going bad, like the brother having an injury or anything of that sort, really hurts him.
Yeah, exactly. You can definitely sense that, you know, from the times, like I mentioned, you know, when McDonald has been in Scotland and you see them together, and you know, obviously when they're back in Kenya, you know, they do feel as though, I mean, you get the sense that they do have a strong familial bond, which is really nice to see. And I think that speaks volumes about the character of Victor himself. You know, he does come across as a very humble and a very determined player. You know, he's not letting a lot of this attention get to his head. I mean, he scored goals against Barcelona. I mean, he's gotten, you know, obviously been praised by Alex Ferguson, Sir Alex Ferguson himself. These are big you know, plaudits for a young player to have, and he seems to be handling it exceptionally well. You know, he seems just to be focused on improving himself, improving his game, and contributing to the success of Celtic. I think that's what makes him so beloved by the Celtic supporters as well. You know, the fact that he is such a likable character, and you feel like you want to cheer him on, you want to feel a pride in his success, you know, because he's got such great character. Let's talk about your relationship with Victor. You've gotten to know him reasonably well in covering his career. Is he as humble and down to earth, you know, as he comes off in interviews as well as on the pitch? And does that translate over? Is he really just that, you know, sort of down to earth type person?
To be sincere, Victor Wanyama is a very humble player, and I've not known him now. I knew him from the days he was playing in the Kenya Premier League for Nairobi City Stars. He was a very young player, very committed. I remember him going to Germany to be a shot. I was the first guy in my country. Guys were not following him, but I did an exclusive Q&A with him. He talked so many good things. You know, he was optimistic. Then all of a sudden, the big bang came. It was Celtic. Everybody all of a sudden realized, hey, there's Victor Wanyama. And let me... I could not believe it. But when he came home, these are humble players. We always used to our players coming, the big players coming, flossing with their big cars. But this is a very humble player. You cannot even know his girlfriend. You cannot even know the car he drives. You'll not see him in a pub jumping up and down. He's so calm. And when he comes, you see when he talks to you, you know, he doesn't have that big name, that star in him. You know, he relaxes. Calls me, calls. No, I want an interview. Tells me this is that. Last month, I remember I was just relaxing at home. All of a sudden, someone called me. I saw a number. Oh, that was Victor. So me calling. What's your skid number? I was like, that's cool. All of a sudden, he came to Kenya. Told me, I have this Chelsea jersey, Celtic jersey for you and your son, and I hope you guys continue supporting us. And these are exceptional abilities from such a player, because not very many players that you know in this world, you know, come up with these things. And even if you see his commitment to Harambee Stars, he's so down to earth. Some players are very below him, some play in Oman, but when he comes there, he's the simplest of players that you can get an interview. That's why I see so many fans in Celtic loving him. And I told him, Victor, to get such love from a strong European base like, say, Scotland is difficult. Hold your horses. Your manager might tell you good things. Manchester's one. But the big thing is, you have to play where you're loved, you're given an opportunity, and you're respected.
Yeah, very well said. I think, you know, several great points there. First off, the fact that, you know, in today's day and age, this is remarkable. You see so many footballers worldwide who, you know, once they have some success and they, you know, start to get some of these plaudits, it goes to their head, you know, and they start to carry themselves a bit differently, and they start to interact with people differently, and you don't get that sense from Victor. And I love that. You know, I love the fact that he has such humility. He knows where he's from, and he treats people, you know, the same now as he did, you know, 3 years ago. And that's just, it's an exception, unfortunately, but it's a beautiful thing to see. And I think it'll serve him quite well throughout his career, staying grounded like that and knowing exactly what's important. And again, you know, I mean, the story about, you know, him bringing the kits to yourself and your son, I mean, that's absolutely phenomenal. You know, that the fact that he maintains the bonds from Kenya, and you know, he treats people with such respect and you know, just civility, and you know, that's absolutely, I think that's something, again, that resonates with us all. Let's shift gears a little bit. You know, you mentioned about, you know, when Victor came to Celtic. How is Celtic perceived amongst African football fans? I mean, obviously, you know, the EPL is going to have the bulk of the attention because it's much easier to see games. You know, let's be honest, worldwide, the EPL is shown everywhere. But since Celtic has had so much success in the Champions League, obviously making it to the knockout stages playing against Juventus, has the profile of Celtic raised at all in, during this time? And what sort of impact has Victor and FA joining Celtic and having such a big impact? What sort of impact has that had on the American football fans' perspective and image of Celtic?
To be looking at it in a broader picture, Celtic has been growing by leaps and bounds over the years, and it's unbelievable. The name Celtic come to Kenya right now. We have even have Kibera Celtic, a young team that is there. Personally, I've been leading from the front because I believe this that we. A lot of people love the EPL. Yes, EPL is good. But now, what about, you know, the SPL? There's fantastic football. Look at when Celtic beat Barcelona. The profile rose. If you could see on Twitter how many Africans are tweeting about Celtic, and all over Africa, all over the world, it was phenomenal. And I believe this thing, you know, it's coming back to us and telling us that football is beyond only EPL because... To us, F. Ambrose, Victor Wanyama, they have also added to this value because personally, I didn't start supporting Celtic now. It is something that has been coming, you know, I've been there. I remember I have my jerseys that were there for a long time. I've been following the history. But when Victor came in there, I was like, God, you've answered my prayers, you know. This is one of the greatest teams that I've ever wanted you to play. That's why even I can tell you something. When I wrote that story, Victor saw a lot of tweets. Victor sent me a DM. He sent me a DM. Ah, Collins, what is that I'm seeing? I told him, Victor, I'm basically trying to say that you have to remain in Celtic. These guys love you. Everyone will say how good Manchester is, but remain there. That is why in Africa, everyone is urging him. The friends, even the family. The father might want him to be in a bigger team. But guys are like saying, remain there. And I believe Celtic, if you give it like two more years, it will be one of the greatest clubs in the world. Because look at how they're performing in the Champions League. They've gone beyond borders, and everyone never expected them to do, you know. And I think that's a great, great feat that they've done. And the sky is not even the limit. They're going to surpass that.
Very well said. I completely agree. You know, in terms of... giving it a couple more years, I mean, what he can do, yes, you know, he's going to be continuing to play in the SPL, but that opportunity to continue to rise his profile and playing through the Champions League or European football in general, I think is a tremendous opportunity. He's going to be really the feature of Celtic going forward if he stays, you know, and that's something that I don't think he would have the opportunity to do, at least right away. If he were to go to Arsenal over the summer or even to Manchester United, that's something that takes time to gain, you know, sort of the trust and the credibility of the manager, which he's already done at Celtic, and I agree completely. I mean, I think that, you know, if his ambition is to go to one of those big clubs, he'd be very well served by staying at least another year and like you said, maybe 2 years to refine his craft and to get to the sort of place where he can go in and make an immediate impact and continue on from there. It's a fantastic point. You mentioned a little bit about the Harambee Stars. I want to talk about, you know, we obviously have a big clash coming up next week between F.A. Ambrose's Super Eagles coming up against your Harambee Stars. Tell us a little bit about that game. And for most Celtic fans around the world, you know, this is F.A. versus Victor. But what are some of the storylines going into this game that we should all be aware of?
First of all, I would like to say this is one of the biggest matches following, you know, if you look at it theoretically, Harambee Stars have never beaten Nigeria. And if on the other side, Nigeria are the newly crowned African Cup of Nations champions.
Yep.
So you can imagine the big, you know, that big hype on the match. Looking at one side, FA on top of Celtic, on top of Nigeria, Wanyama on top of Kenya, and one of the best players. So it's kind of, it's something that I call, it's going to be a ding-dong battle. Because... this is one of the best team because Nigeria has always beaten us 3-0, 2-0. But this time round, we have our fresh young Victor Wanyama. And from what that I've gotten, I'm not sure if he'll be playing. But even if he is playing, I think it was it will be rivalry, but also camaraderie, that whereby they'll be fighting for the battle, because all these teams came to qualify for the World Cup. Kenya, looking at it, think we don't have that realistic, but we still have the, because we have a new player, he loves Victor Wanyama, and right now, without lying, Victor Wanyama is the key to beating Nigeria. Though the coach, Stephen Keshi, says that Kenya is still the underdogs, we don't believe in that. We believe that we have the proper players, that if all goes well in that particular match, it's going to be a tough match for every team, both Nigeria and Kenya.
Yeah, very well said. I have a particularly keen eye on this game, because I think, as you mentioned, Kenya does get sort of passed over in some of the ratings, and as we look ahead to Brazil next year, I mean, it, you know, if you can believe it, the World Cup is coming up next year. You know, Kenya, you know, I mean, they do have some top quality players, but they can never, you know, at least for the recent past, you know, the past couple of World Cup cycles, you know, just doesn't, it hasn't seemed to come off for them. But I think, you know, like you mentioned, Victor Wanyama and some of the other, you know, talent that's really coming through that Kenyan side, if they can glue it together, I you know, like you said, I think the sky's the limit for that. With an eye towards the World Cup next year, it's hard to believe. You know, obviously, there's the historical favorites coming from CAF. You know, the Cameroon, the Ghana, South Africa, maybe Ivory Coast. You know, those sorts of teams. But who are some of the other teams? I mean, obviously, you'd have to put Kenya in there. But who are some of the other teams that we need to keep an eye on that you know might be, you know, not the favorites to qualify, but may surprise some people. Who do we need to keep our eye on?
Right now, what I can say, football dynamics is really changing in Africa. If you look at the big boys, the Nigerians, the Cameroon, the Senegal, they have not been doing the best, because you see young teams like Togo, Sudan coming up. So at this particular moment, what I can say is that it's never over until it's over, because all these teams are fighting to qualify. Look at Cameroon, one of the biggest teams with the best talent. Some of the players are playing in Europe, but they could not even make it to the African Cup of Nations.
Yeah.
Ghana, we remember what they did in the World Cup 2010. We hope they're going to make it. Sudan is also playing very hard there. It's a new team, very young, vulnerable, but they're showing people that, yes, they can. Nigeria have just performed very well. They are working so hard to fight to be able to pass through this group. Teams like Senegal have people like Demba Ba. But the problem is that they have star players, but when it comes to playing as a unit, it becomes difficult. So let's look at small teams like Sudan, teams like Ghana, who have been consistent. You know, looking at teams like Tanzania, yeah. At the end of the day, we are going to see a shift in from those big boys to the underdogs taking over this championship also.
Fantastic stuff. We're listening to Collins Okenyo, Kenyan journalist. He's followed the career path of Victor Wanyama as well as F.A. Ambrose. Fantastic work that you do. If you haven't checked out his writing, please do so. Some of his latest articles were on republicfootball.net. Collins, where can we find you on Twitter? And then where can we also find some of your other writing? For some of the listeners who may not be familiar with your work, who want to check it out, give us a sense for where to find you.
Okay, basically, one thing I'd like to speak to the Celtic fans is, well, first of all, I'd like to say they are the most amazing fans. Most of my Twitter fans, my Twitter followers, they are Celtic fans who live in Scotland. Just a few live on the other side. Coming to where you can get me, I'm at Twitter, I'm on Belgius SN. That's where you can get me on Twitter, or when you want to get me on Facebook, my name is Collins Okenyo. But mostly, like right now, I'm not in my country, I'm in Zambia. I write for supersport.com, which is the biggest broadcaster in Africa. But one thing I also like to add before I end all this, I'm looking forward for that great day when I'll be there at watching one of the biggest Celtic matches together with the fans. That atmosphere, that is my dream. And I believe it's going to happen.
Collins, let me tell you, I went to Celtic Park for the first time last month for the Juventus game. And even though it wasn't a good result, you know, it didn't turn out the way I had hoped for Celtic, it was absolutely magical. You have to go. I mean, please, if you have the means, you know, when you can make it, please go. You won't be disappointed. I mean, there's nothing like it. You will thoroughly enjoy it. I promise you. It's a special place. Like you said, the fans are like nothing else on the face of the earth, and it's just it fills me with a source of pride. And please keep doing the great work that you're doing. I'm gonna send a tweet out with your Twitter link as well as the website where we can find you, and I'll retweet some of your articles. And please keep up the great work. And hopefully we can call on you again, you know, as we get into the summer months where a lot of this transfer window speculation is going to heat up. And, you know, so we can continue to hear your insight into, you know, the career path of Victor Wanyama as well as F. Ambrose. Okay, I think Skype locked up on me. So I'm having all sorts of audio issues today. Hopefully the show is still on. We lost Collins, unfortunately. So, trying to get it back. This is an absolute nightmare. And as you can see, Skype just restarted. So Collins, thank you so much for joining us. See if we can maybe try and get him back, or here he is.
You seem to have lost me.
Collins, I'm sorry, pal. You know, I'm having all sorts of computer issues today, and it just it's the danger of live radio, working without a net.
Yeah.
But you know,
no problem.
So I apologize. But what I was saying is, you know, please keep up the great work that you're doing. I think we lost them again. Yeah, that's the challenge of doing live radio and trying to Skype across the world, really. It's an imperfect science. We'll just leave it at that. But Collins Aquino, I'm sending out a tweet right now where you can find him on Twitter. And I mean, just fantastic stuff. Like I mentioned sort of in the opening there, where, you know, oftentimes there is an agenda.
Yeah, sorry for that again.
Oh, no problem, Collins. It's we're just trying to deal with technical issues, and when we're trying to connect, technology is great when it works, but when we're trying to connect from all the way on the other side of the world, I mean, think about that. You know, you're in Zambia, and I'm on the east coast of the U.S. You know, it's sometimes this happens, but thank you.
Yeah.
But thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to send out a tweet with your Twitter Twitter handle, as well as some links to find you there. And hopefully we can call on you again as we get into the summer months where the transfer window starts heating up and a lot of that speculation comes in, because I want to get your insight into that and certainly the careers of Victor Wanyama, F. Ambrose, and get caught up and stay tuned in with what's going on in African football. Would that be okay if we checked in with you from time to time?
No problem. All the time. Anytime you want to check on me, I'll be available. That's what I promise you.
Fantastic stuff.
It's been wonderful. Thank you a lot for this great show.
Fantastic stuff. All the best to you, pal.
All the best to you, too.
All right. Cheers. Collins, yes. Collins Aquino joining us all the way from Zambia through some technical issues. What can you say? You know, it happens. Like I was saying here, It's an amazing thing, you know, trying to connect with folks from all over the world. It's an amazing thing, but you know, it keeps us very well informed, you know, not just from the usual media sources where, you know, obviously there's an agenda, you know, and you know, the Scottish hacks want to, they already have the theme of the story that they want to put out already. It's just a matter of asking the appropriate questions to get the responses that will allow them to spin the story in a certain way. And from Collins, you know, we can get a sense for not just, you know, someone who's covering Victor Wanyama and covering his international exploits and who's followed his career, but someone who has a personal connection there, to give us some more insight into, you know, what sort of person Victor Wanyama is. I mean, I think we get a good sense of that by watching him on the pitch, being interviewed, you know, and just the way he carries himself. It's something to really be emulated. And you know, if you haven't, as I mentioned, I can't say this enough, if you haven't checked out Collins' work, please do so. I'm going to be sending out a tweet here where you can find him, and hopefully we can have him back. And, you know, after I get all this technical rubbish taken care of. So Skype lines are open now. And if you have thoughts on the game today, are you up after the game? I mean, you know, are you sort of riding a high? Are you, You know, are you still wary about, I mean, let's be honest, this was not a spectacular performance, you know, in a very specific sense, in a general sense. You know, yes, we got the 3 points, but, you know, there still is some uncertainty there, some apprehension. I mean, there's some things that really need to be ironed out. We should not be in a position where we need to win a game like this. I mean, yes, it's fantastic that we did so and that we got the 3 points, and especially in such an exciting way where the players fought on. But, you know, you can't go week after week playing this way. You know, you have to sort out the basics so that we can get back to playing, you know, the usual dominant football that we are capable of playing. So I want to hear from you. I want to hear your thoughts. Are you up after this game? Are you positive? Are you hopeful going forward? Or, you know, I mean, did we just sort of sneak by? Joining us now is Jerry McMahon, all the way from the friendly confines of Glasgow. Hello, Jerry. Thanks so much for joining us.
Good evening, Graham. Always great to be on the show. Decided to forego the pub and come home.
Ah, lovely. I'm
delighted I did so. just so many points to cover, Graham, in the next few minutes. First of all,
there really is. I mean, it's hard to do a 2-hour show and try and fit all of the issues in. It's
I promise you, I'll only take an hour and a half of your time.
You might need to repeat it.
First of all, the Celtic Graves, the show last week was, I thought, fantastic and a great education for me personally. I mean, I did know a little bit about the work of Jim and the Celtic Graves team, but I thought it was just so educational. And, you know, I think I've said this before, that you think you've run out of reasons why you love supporting Celtic. And last week, I think Jim gave me a few more, and I tweeted him and yourself to say that. And, you know, anybody that didn't hear it, I would recommend they listen to it, because it was just, you know, such an education. And, you know, I'm glad that you get so much out of it. So well done. Well done there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Fantastic stuff. Same again to Collins there. I mean, I did catch a wee bit of it there coming out of the shower. But it was interesting that so many people were advising him to stay. And, you know, I would like nothing better than to see Victor being with us for another season or two. Because I think, you know, particularly in the Champions League, what he brings to the table, you know, he's got a maturity beyond his years at times in the big matches. And I would love him to be there, particularly in the qualifying rounds next year, which I think will be fraught with danger for us. So, thanks again for that. Just wanted to touch on a couple of points about today. First of all, absolutely ecstatic, Graham. He didn't look good at 3-1 down.
It sure didn't.
I think it was a sloppy performance. But, funnily enough, that used to be the hallmark of Celtic, to go a goal behind, two behind.
Oh, I mean, think about the Tommy Burns years, you know? I mean, how many times were we in that situation?
But even going back there, I remember in my early days going to Tynecastle and winning 4-3, you know, being behind in the days of, you know, Jimmy Johnston, in my very youngest days as a Celtic fan. But somebody tweeted a few weeks ago that I think we'd gone behind something like 10 or 11 times this season and only come back twice, which, you know, is most unlike Celtic. And, you know, I'm always looking for hopeful signs, and I think the fact today that, you know, we weren't just one goal behind, but we were two goals behind. And the fact that we come back, I'm hoping that gives what is still a fairly young team in a lot of respects, you know, the belief now that when they go behind in any game, that they can turn it round. And, you know, the way the stadium got behind the team when we got the second goal, you know, it was just like the old-fashioned Celtic. And, you know, fantastic. And, you know, I think you said it about Sammy. He did transform the game, and delighted. The one point I don't know if you picked up today through your Twitter feed is that I walked home today because my daughter wasn't at the match, and I listened to Clyde. And I don't know if you're picking this up, but there now seems to be a concerted effort to get Sevco parachuted back into the top league. One of the main reasons that they're using is the poor crowds, and you know the lack of what they say is a competitor for Celtic and for Rangers. Now, I don't doubt that that is part of the reason why the crowds have gone down. You know, I know myself that some fans have decided not to go. But the idea that, given the crimes that this team committed over the last 10 or 11 years, that they should be parachuted back into the SPL, I think is bordering on ludicrous. And, you know, I think that the Celtic support have got to unite with the other Scottish fans and try and make sure that we prevent that. Because I think if the crowds are poor at the moment, it would actually empty the stadiums if these people are allowed back in. I think it's a scandal that they weren't stripped of titles for their cheating. And, you know, it's a complete nonsense that the media are now getting behind this idea. So I don't know what your thoughts are on the match today and what I've just said, Graham.
For me personally, I mean, I wanted to open it up, you know, obviously from both sides. I mean, there's a couple of different perspectives that you can take from today. First being the fact that for 70 minutes we saw once again, you know, the team that, you know, went out, scored an early goal and, you know, just shrunk back into the game, you know, and just sort of fell away. And we saw the product of that going 2-1 down and then, of course, 3-1 down. There's also the other perspective that takes a look at this, and this is where essentially I am. I, you know, believe it or not, I like to be a glass half full sort of perspective. I don't like being doom and gloom and ranting and everything. But what I look at from this game is the analogy and the connection from the past, and that would be for me the Kilmarnock game of October of last year. You know, you look at that game and where we were at that point. You know, on the heels of several bad performances in a row on the bounce, and then you know you have that sort of rebirth. You know, and that fight that came back into the side. And look at what happened after that. You know, I mean, Neil Lennon's on the verge of resigning at halftime. You know, he's starting to think about his future in terms of how that is all pertains. Team fights back. We get the 3-3 result, and then we bridge the gap by New Year's of the now deceased Rangers. And I that's what the sort of connection that I find from this. Seeing Gary Hooper score that goal, pick the ball up out of the net, and then run back to the center circle and put it down. I mean, you know, that's a direct analogy. I mean, think about, you know, that game at Rugby Park. You know, Anthony Stokes picks the ball up, runs back. Charlie Mulgrew does the same thing. You know, that's the way I want to look at this. You know, I want to look at this from the standpoint of, yes, we've had some ropey performances over the past several weeks, no question about it. But this is the type of result and outcome that can really spur the team on, I think, and really come together through this. And it's perfect timing. I mean, you know, we have so much still to play for. I mean, I want to clinch the league as soon as possible. And of course, I want to exorcise these ghosts from Hampden, and I think that a good run of form going into these games and really, you know, finding our rhythm, getting everything clicking into gear, all the cliches that you want to, you know, mash up into it. I'm feeling very positive out of the result personally.
Absolutely, Graham. I mean, at the end of the day, there have been problems this season. I mean, I thought the figure that we dropped 28 points, I found that remarkable. But, I mean, I spoke to my friend today at the match, and what we did say is that I don't think it's so much missing Sevco. I think it's missing a competitor that's breathing down your neck. You know, that means that you have to win a game and that you need to pull out all the stops. I don't doubt for a second that there's been a degree of complacency from the players at times, because they probably know in their hearts that, you know, they step up to the plate often enough, they'll get the victory. And, you know, I think that's a key point that needs to be made by Celtic fans, is that it's the lack of a competitor, it's not the lack of Rangers that's the problem in the SPL. They are down where they belong. And, you know, that they've got off extremely lightly in terms of everything that's happened. It's an absolute scandal that they weren't stripped of titles. But we have missed a competitor. I think it has had an impact in the attendances, without any doubt. And, it, you know, it's only a shame that they are the only team that have a big support and have the potential to challenge us. But any idea that they should be parachuted back in, I think, is absolutely ludicrous. But I agree with you, Graham, in terms of today's game. That does give us plenty of room for optimism. But one thing that possibly might have escaped your attention is the number of injuries we've had. Mm. You know, Scott Brown out again. Matthews injured. So many times this season, we've lost 2-3 players who have been playing really well. Wee Forrest was missing today as well. So, you know, he hasn't had that many opportunities to get what he would regard as his success, his best team on the park, and start to get them to win consistently. But we've had a lot more decent performances, I think, since November to March than we have had poor performances. Yes, you know, we lost to Motherwell, we lost to Ross County, and we drew with St Johnstone. But there are quite a few occasions we've scored 4 and 5 goals, and we've looked like a team again. So, yes, it's been a bit mixed bag, but I think that there's room for optimism, Graham.
Oh, no question about it. You know, there's a couple of points that I want to touch on that are particularly salient. I'm glad that you brought these up, and I think they're worthwhile. First off, you know, the fact that I would agree completely that not having a close competitor driving us on at all times, I think it'd be foolish to claim that that's not having an impact. It certainly is. But your point that I think is an important one. You know, there's this default position amongst the mainstream media, and I think, you know, we've been conditioned to think so as well. Who gave Sevco the God-given right that they need to be the close competitor? We just need a close competitor. Nobody said anything about Sevco needing to be that team. And quite frankly, if Sevco were on the top flight, I'm not even so sure they would be second place just now. I mean, considering some of the results, I mean, they need a dodgy penalty every week just to get past, I don't know, Athletic or East Stirlingshire or, you know, whoever. So the fact that, you know, they're by default our close competitor, you know, because of the rivalry that the now deceased legacy club to the current zombie status club had with Celtic, I think is absolutely ludicrous. And it's a point that's really lost on certainly the mainstream media, but I think a lot of us as well. And it's the type of point that I think is worthwhile pointing out. So thank you for mentioning that. You know, in terms of you know, the injuries, I think that's an important point as well. I mean, we're just hearing now that James Forrest is going to need an injection. He's probably going to be out for another couple weeks, and I think that's a big miss, not just from the standpoint of what he brings when he's on form, but as we've seen, you know, it takes him maybe 2-3 games, and it's understandable, you know, to get back into playing form, you know, and I think that, you know, we've seen situations, most notably in that first leg against Juventus, where, you know, James Forrest was thrust back into the side without much, you know, in the way of sort of recuperation or just, you know, maybe some games and some runouts, you know, to get his fitness back and his form dipped. But, you know, after a couple of games, we started to see that dynamic flair and that playmaking ability that he has that can have such a big impact on a game. And it's unfortunate that it seems as though, once again, he's fallen out. You know, it's the type of situation where, you know, he's got his detractors now because people, you know, they point out the fact that he breaks down easy. And, you know, to a certain extent, maybe that's fair, maybe it isn't. You know, considering how much football we've had to play with Champions League and cup ties and so on and so forth, you know, that has a tendency to wear on certain players, and especially with the sort of beating that he takes, running down the, you know, the flank each and every week, and he has zero protection from the referees. I think he's a special player, and I think that his absence is certainly felt, you know, especially in light of what I've mentioned earlier, where Cholo Mogru just being thrown into the midfield, where I don't think he's suited to play. You know, I think that has an effect on the team. Whereas if Forrest and maybe some other players were available, you know, we would have a different sort of capacity to the team. It's an important point.
Yeah, I mean, see for James Forrest, Graham. I mean, I think prior to Christmas, when Scott Brown was really feeling his injury, Lenny was saying, look, I think we might need to shut him down and get him sorted. And I think, to be honest with James Forrest, that is exactly what we need to do, because he's hardly started this season. He's had 2 or 3 games. He's been out with an injury. It's been stop, start, stop, start. And I kind of think he's potentially such a big talent that we have to, well, look, let's get you and let's let you see this specialist. Let's identify the problem and let's give you as much time to recover as is required. Because, you know, we have seen this situation in the past where great talent have had to quit the game because of niggling injuries that don't clear up. So I think we have to do that. Now, two other points I did want to pick up on, Graham, and one of them is this old idea of inconsistency and, you know, what's happened this season is particularly bad. And, you know, unfortunately for me, I've supported Celtic for 42 years. And I remember under Jock Stein and Billy McNeil, we reached 13 League Cup finals in a row, I'm sure, and I think we won two of them. Now, that included under Jock Stein losing 4-1 to Partick Thistle, you know, I think a year after we got to the European Cup final. And, you know, time after time, we've fallen at the final hurdle against opponents that you would normally expect to beat. And that was at a time when we were a much stronger force in Europe than we were now. So I think we do let ourselves down, but I think it's something that's been there that's historical and we've never been able to shake it off. But I'm hoping, you know, Neil learns some of the lessons of the last couple of years. And I've every belief that we'll beat Dundee United to go on and win the Scottish Cup. So I think anybody who's young that thinks this is a new feature this season, that isn't at all. And I think I said this to you 2 or 3 weeks ago, Graham. What we've done in the Champions League and the fact that we're in pole position to win the Championship, I think it still means that it's been an excellent season for us. And last thing, Graham, is a comment on your music. I couldn't believe when you put Damien Dempsey on. You know, I've got the album sitting here and I can't believe somebody in Washington, D.C. is playing the same music as me. And I just wanted to ask you what the song was prior to that, the song about celebrating St. Paddy's Day in New York, because it was a fantastic song. And I didn't know whether it was the silences or not. Can you enlighten me?
Sure thing. Yeah. Thanks for the compliments on the choice of music. I do spend a lot of time on that. the St. Patrick's Day song that was played in the beginning of the show is by Johnny Mac and the Faithful, and I think it's called St. Patrick's Day, New York. And the Damien Dempsey song is Negative Vibes, and I think that. I mean, obviously, I played St. Patrick's Day in New York with it being St. Patrick's Day weekend. And, you know, I think the Negative Vibes song by Damien Dempsey, you know, just really plays to, you know, what we're feeling right now. I mean, you know, there's a lot of cynicism and skepticism and sort of down feeling about the team, you know, going into this game and certainly through halftime. I mean, it just seemed like a continuation. And especially because of the police brutality. I mean, let's not kid ourselves and call it something that it isn't. It's police brutality. It's harassment that's coming from Strathclyde Police. I mean, God forbid there was an emergency in Glasgow today, or else, you know, the citizens would have been absolutely gubbed. The fact that we need hundreds of police officers to patrol and to corral as they did, you know, just football fans. And you know, I mean, you know, let's also not kid ourselves about the fact that they are Celtic supporters. That's clearly the reason why. I think it's absolutely atrocious. And it's there's a lot of sort of negative vibes that are floating around. But like you mentioned and like you alluded to, you know, from the interview last week with Jim from Celtic Graves, there's so much to be proud of and to be thankful of, you know, by supporting Celtic and to be appreciative of in terms of what's going on just now. It's very easy to get caught up in the here and now and to sort of hang our heads. But in the bigger picture, as you've highlighted here, there's so much that's just absolutely wonderful that's going on with the club just now. I just spoke to a journalist from Kenya who's in Zambia right now, who's a Celtic supporter, who's got nothing but, you know, just you know, wonderful things to say about Celtic. I think that speaks volumes to what's going on with Celtic. And you know, so I thought it was a poignant time to bring that up, in addition to the computer issues that I'm having today.
Johnny Mac and the Faithful, the club play the Neil Lennon song
right
at halftime most weeks, and that's a brilliant song. I must check that out, because That to me is two stunning, stunningly good songs, the Lenny song and the New York St. Patrick's Day one. I mean, in terms of the Green Brigade, I saw some of the photos today, and it just looked ludicrous. The, you know, the number of police, the fact that they were kettled in, you know, it just seems totally bizarre and unfathomable to me. You know, it's very, very odd. And I think it does have an impact on the atmosphere in the stadium, because I thought the Green Brigade were there. They sang today, but there was a flatness. But if I was being kettled in against my wishes, and which I think is essentially undemocratic, you know, I certainly wouldn't feel in top gear walking into the stadium. And I think I share your view that the club needs to come out now and speak to the police and say, what on earth is going on here? Let's sit down, let's get these problems ironed out, and let's get these people inside the stadium, bringing the special qualities that they do to the club. So, yes, time to stand up for them and, you know, support the Green Brigade. I support you 100%. So again, Graham, as always, superb show. Keep up the good work, and more good music choices next match.
Cheers, Jerry. Thanks so much for calling in, and we'll talk to you soon. All the best.
Hail, hail, Graham.
Hail, hail, pal. That's Jerry McMahon getting in touch, and I can see Paulie from Drum Chapel is chomping at the bit. So, Paulie, for listening, get in touch. Got to wait your turn, though. There's a queue. We need to be orderly with this. Can't have it just haphazard. So, Paulie, get in touch. Want to hear from you. Obviously, Paul does a fantastic job running the Free Galley Show on Spreaker from time to time, and you know, cranking out the tunes on Friday nights and otherwise. So, fantastic stuff from him, and I'm sure that he has an opinion on today. Love to hear from him. So, Jerry had some fantastic points, you know, as well, talking about the fact that, you know, who has anointed Sevco? You know, why does Sevco need to be the challenger? I mean, granted, I think that, you know, I think that we can say that we do need, you know, something of a challenge. You know, I think that in a certain sense that is lacking. But, you know, why there seems to be this assumption that it needs to be Sevco is absolutely, you know, that's preposterous. If I'm Motherwell, or if I'm, you know, Inverness, or you know, one of the other clubs in the SPL that are challenging, I mean, let's be honest, pretty much everybody 2 through 8 is challenging for that second spot. Why should Sevco get parachuted in? And even if they did get parachuted in, I'm not even so sure they would be a challenge to us. You know, needing dodgy penalties against Annan Athletic and East Stirlingshire. Paul, are you there?
I'm here.
Yeah, there he is, you madman. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for calling in. Come on, let us have it.
How you doing, big fella? All right?
Yeah, doing fine. I want to hear from you. I know you have some thoughts on the game today, as well as some of the treatment that the Green Brigade picked up, and you know, everything that's going on. I mean, there's so many issues.
I want to start off I wanted to speak politely since I'm speaking across the water. First of all, I want to see that last 10 minutes of that game. That is the best buzz I've had at the football for a long, long time. It was absolutely brilliant. And that's see your £500. I would have paid £500 just for today, right? At the football.
Yeah.
It was brilliant. Me and my wee boy jumped about, gone absolutely crazy in that fourth quarter, and it was brilliant. But another aspect of things now, I wasn't on the cordial today because wee Paddy was over to Belfast, and I had to meet him at our pub after he flew in and all that, so I never got the other day. But I've heard some reports, I've spoken to a few people, and it's just absolutely disgusting. What's happened today? It's an absolute disgrace. I mean, I don't even know where to start with it.
What can be done? Polly, let me ask you, what can be done? Something needs to be done. I mean, the silence is deafening coming from Celtic Park just now. You know, as I alluded to, their own revenue stream. That's how they look at us. They look at us as customers. Their own customers are being harassed, and their ability to bring in money to keep their entity going is being threatened for absolutely no reason. I mean, it's just blatant harassment. The fact that all of these cases are thrown out immediately says it all, and yet the club does nothing to protect its own supporters, which is how they should look at us, but its own revenue stream, and they do nothing.
No, exactly. I helped the last caller. Jerry is he was saying, oh, the club need to do this, and the club need to start. The club are complicit in all this. They are part of the problem. Let's not be beating about the bush here, saying the club need to reconcile with us, or the club need to do that. It's them that fucking started this.
How so?
Well, they signed up to all this offensive behaviour, but they never stood up and said anything about it at the time. And this is the benefits here.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
They've sat back and done nothing for years. For years they've done nothing. All they've done is take their fucking money, and it's an absolute disgrace. And the police have got carte blanche now. Police have got carte blanche because the club says, oh, if he signs about the IRA, you can jail him. It's a fucking disgrace. The whole shooting match is an absolute scandal. And I'm telling you, if it doesn't change, it's going to be... I don't even want to think about it, but it's going to be...
I mean, it's gone beyond the IRA singing or chanting or banners or anything else. I mean, this is a situation where a group of football supporters, I mean, remove the Green Brigade tag or Celtic fan or whatever. I mean, just put that to the side. Put that to the side for 1 second. I mean, let's look at it in the elemental level. A group of people assembled at a pub and decided they were going to go for a walk together. Now, all of a sudden, that's termed as a demonstration that you need a permit for? I mean, please, it's beyond farcical. It's gone beyond any sort of justification. Anybody who can justify why these supporters were corralled up like cattle today for just marching, for walking together, you're on a completely different planet. I'm sorry. You know, if you can justify that, you're
I think everybody expected it to be a wee bit of harassment. The police, a wee bit of a wind up, but nothing like what happened. I'll tell you this, Graham. I'm glad I've got a wee boy, a wee paddy was there for Ireland today, because I'd have been arrested today. I couldn't have stood and took that. I'm glad I wasn't there, to be honest.
I mean, where does it end? You know, we've seen an escalation of this. You know, it started with no lateral movement, no illicit chanting, no jumping, no standing, and then it's progressed. You know, you can't have that banner. We're going to kick you out for that. We have pictures of you. You can't come into the ground if you want to assemble in front of the stadium. Now you can't even go for a walk. When does it stop?
Hey, well, I'll tell you, my brother left at halftime, right, the cock. And my brother-in-law and my nephew wasn't at the game, so... See, at half time, I went up to 111, up at the back of 111, we Eamon and we Paddy, me and my young boy, and we're up there, and obviously it was kind of flat because everything happened, but I know, it was pointed out to me, see it in the roof of the stadium, in the roof of the north stand, there's a camera built into the roof, pointing right in the section of 111, a camera built into the roof. It's only happened a couple of weeks ago, apparently. Unbelievable, it's just pointed right into the section. I can't see it from my seat, but when I'm up the other day, it's just unbelievable.
I mean, it appears as though there's
complicit in that. You've got to fucking put it there.
I've been saying this for weeks. I mean, how is the club, you know, able to just stand by and allow its own supporters at their own ground just be harassed like this, having your picture taken, having your door chapped? I mean, you know, we've seen the Facebook posts of these focus officers, and yes, they lost their jobs or they were reassigned or whatever it is, but it's clear, it's blatant. You know, what other football club in Scotland is having to go through all this bother? None that I can see. You know, I mean, if there were, there would be a cooperative effort to quell this. You know, like we saw last season with the Huns. Yeah, but you're not seeing that, you know, and
it's all part of Scottish society, Graham. I mean, they disrespect you, but it's just what we expect. I mean, and they say that times have moved on and everything else, but let's face it, we live in a loyalist shithole, and that's never changed. they're dying to do us. And that bill came in last year, even up the score. That's all that was, offensive behaviour.
Well, exactly, and we knew that this was the potential of it. That this is why there was the outcry. This is what was why there was the fans against criminalization that came up, you know, through this. And nothing was done, to your point, nothing was done from the club. The club stood idly by and allowed this to come through, and we're seeing the product of it.
Exactly. And not just the club, plenty of supporters clubs as well. They all put out their banners that day, all Celtic fans against the bill and that. They've done fuck all since, basically. They've done fuck all, but stand idly by while people have been harassed and arrested and all the rest of it. And in the day, there's a combination of all that stuff. And it's sickening because, see the football, obviously I never made the court show, and see the football was buzzing, me and my wee boy, when that goal went in, it was absolutely amazing. I don't want to lose that.
No, I don't either. I don't want to lose that. I don't want to lose the atmosphere and the environment that the Green Brigade provide, because it's clear, you know, when they're not in the ground, I mean, it's like night and day. And I don't want to lose that. You know, I mean, that's something.
It's not just about the Green Brigade. It's about us all.
Well, and that's a good point. I mean, let's say, you know, God forbid they do, stamp out the Green Brigade. There is no Green Brigade anymore next season. Let's just imagine that for a second. I mean, who are they going to go after next? And for what? You know, I mean, you can't. Okay, so you can't gather. You know, you can only walk in pairs. What's next? You have to walk in single file, or else you get done. I mean, it's, where does this end?
So that's an absolute scandal. I'm going to meet my mate. We're all going to meet up outside the pub and walk to the game. I mean, it's just a fucking scandal. I don't.
What do we do? How do we affect change? I mean, what do we stay away? I mean, do we get petitions together? Do we petition the board? How do we get Peter Lowell's attention to let him know that something needs to be done about this? Because something needs to be done. What can we do?
I don't know what the answer is, Graham. I really don't know what the answer is. The answer is for everybody to stay away, but that's easier said than done.
Yeah, you're right.
I don't want to stay away.
Right.
I'm going to see Celtic. I love taking my son to see Celtic. I love it. I don't want to stay away. But that is the... That is going to end up being. That's
only Hitler. You're right. I mean, it goes completely contrary. It goes completely contrary to any instinct that you have. I mean, people are desperate to go and support the club. People want to go out to the stadium, you know. And to say that the only way that we can get something accomplished by it is to stay away is incredibly hard. You know, and but I mean, to that point, you know, the club understands that. And like always, they exploit the loyalty of the support.
Aye, you know, it's fucking sickening. Anyway, I want to leave on a happy note.
All right, cheer us up.
See when he goes, and I was just walking down the stairs, me and my son, and I just gave a high five to the sniper and all that as I was walking out, and just as I was walking out, that fourth goal, and I swear to God, the place erupted. Well, really bit erupted. I was up in the barriers giving Aberdeen fans. Oh,
get it up, yeah.
They were giving us it tight for a good half hour.
Yeah, sure they were.
But it's a long journey home.
Hey, fantastic stuff. All right, Mon the Vardy, Bob Rolls, and we'll catch up with you soon. Cheers, Paul. Hello, that's Paul from Drum Chapel. He's good crack, Paul. And, you know, very good points. I mean, something needs to be done, but what do we do? That's the issue here. Just hearing from Deco, obviously from Aurora Celtic fame, speaking of good crack. He says himself and 200 or 300 Tims jumping up and down on a Philly subway train with this gobshite, talking about himself, singing, shouting, getting them going. I get a pat on the back from the police, not harassed by the police. This is all bollocks. And it's absolutely right. We go everywhere in Europe and we're applauded. The Italian newspapers, you know, shower praise all over us throughout, you know, all of their papers. And what do we get? The shower of filth in the Scottish mainstream media that does absolutely nothing but want to slag Celtic and want to big up a third division first year club, trying to parachute them into the top flight. And the police and it appears the club itself are all complicit in this. It makes absolutely no sense how this could happen. And it's all contrived, and it's all bias, and it's sectarian in nature. You then want to talk about Timmy conspiracies. Give me a break. I mean, it's beyond nauseating. I'm sick of it. Something needs to be done. I'm at a loss as to what. I mean, is it... If you try and protest, if you try and have a peaceful protest, you get done for it. If you try and have banners, you get done for it. If you try and sing about it, you get done for it. And, you know, if you try and call a boycott or something to that effect, you get slagged right off from the start. I don't know. I don't know. I don't have any answers in terms of, you know, what to do. But we need to start thinking about it because something needs to get done. We're not joined by the gaffer. Hello, gaffer. Hello.
Who?
There he is. You're live on the Beyond the Wave Celtic Football Show. How are you, pal?
Yeah, I'm great. Well, next, maybe.
What are you eating?
Well, I was just putting about a bunch of apples. I put my mic away and you called me back.
Oh. Well, you know, one at a time, Gaffer, one at a time. Well, so what are these wrappers? What are you eating?
Oh, it was bar chocolate.
Oh, it was bar chocolate. What kind of chocolate?
it was a Whisper.
A Whisper?
Whisper.
Whisper?
Yeah.
Oh. What's that like? Does that have, like, caramel in it, or is it just straight-up chocolate?
It's just bubbly chocolate.
Ah, bubbly chocolate. That sounds lovely. Well, fantastic. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for joining us. Well, what did you make of the game today? It was pretty much 75 minutes of slop and filth, and then, you know, pop the champagne at the end, wouldn't you say?
It was an incredible game in hindsight. Game kicks off, and, you know, start of the game, I was quite hungry, and I was thinking I might just quickly go down for pie. Now, the first few minutes might be a bit dry. Luckily, I didn't. You know, 12 seconds in. Fantastic goal.
Josh, sit down.
yeah, and then you're right. You know, an attack were a little bit ineffective, wasting the ball too easily. And then defence today, I didn't actually see the first Aberdeen goal, but I've seen all the ones and, you know, just lackluster.
Well, I mean, the second goal, I mean, it was clear as day. You know, Ambrose is nowhere to be found, and Wilson decides too late that he's going to, you know, track the runner that runs right across him. And, I mean, Forster was completely exposed. Yes, he probably could have done and should have done better in stopping it. But I mean, it was just a complete mental lapse by Kelvin Wilson. Kelvin Wilson had some ups and downs. I mean, he had some exceptional plays in this game. But, you know, I mean, he had some absolute howlers in this game. You know, We've seen a lot of chopping and changing with that back four. That's really been the hallmark of Neil Lennon's time as manager at Celtic. But, I mean, do we need a bit more consistency at center half? I mean, you know, is Ronja going to be back there? Is Ambrose going to be back there? I think that, you know, all things told, I think that Wilson and Ambrose are probably our best pairing back there. I mean, if you take Wanyama aside, I mean, yes, Wanyama, you know, can do a job at center half, but he's really a midfielder. I mean, you know, let's not kid ourselves. I mean, do we need a run of games with them playing together to get that confidence back? I mean, is this a situation where we need to continue tinkering to find that right mix? I mean, for me, I think we found the right mix throughout the fall, throughout, you know, as many clean sheets as we had throughout the fall. And, you know, through injuries and through, you know, the African Cup of Nations, where, you know, Ambrose was away for an entire month and he just never has seemed to regain his form, and that's translated over to Wilson. You know, it's gotten a bit dodgy at times, but, you know, I firmly believe that this result today and the comeback is really going to bring the team and the club together. I really hope. I'm looking at that Kilmarnock game from last season as the example here, but... I mean, is it time to maybe sit Ambrose down, you know, given his lapses in form and concentration, or maybe give, you know, Wilson some time out? Or is that really the crux of the problem? I mean, do we need some more stability there?
I'd say both of the defenders, like, you know, it's like Ambrose has a bit of a mistake, a slip up, and then Wilson has a bit of a slip up. I think the two of them just, you know, really need to get that together and just really clean up their play. Obviously, both of them can be fantastic players at times, but, you know, they've just got to keep their concentration. And it looked like that what it might have been today. You know, the two of them, you know, Celtic got the majority of possession, you know, holding at midfield well, and then Aberdeen, you know, counter-attack, and, you know, just being caught off guard a little bit. That's what it seemed to me. But, you know, today, it's, you know, it's definitely one of the landmark games that you've got to look back on and say, you know, I remember that game for this season, like the Kilmarnock game from last season. Just a fantastic spirited comeback.
I think you're right.
Yeah. When the second goal went in, you know, 3-2, I thought we'd be really, really lucky to get a draw.
Mm.
You know, the atmosphere on the ground was quite hostile, even at that moment, towards Lennon and the players, because, you know, we've not been in the best of form as of late.
Well, and it's certainly never a given. I mean, especially with about, I think at that point there was 15 minutes left and you needed another goal. But, I mean, we've been so anemic, especially at the end of games lately. It certainly wasn't, you didn't have that feeling like, okay, let's build something here. It was like you said, we'd be lucky to get the draw.
Yeah, and then we'll make a few changes. Samaras comes on, Lassad comes on. Lassad wasn't doing too well, but then Gary Hooper gets a goal, 87th minute, and I was like, yeah, that was a good game. We did really, really well to get a draw, and then out of nowhere, Samaras, 94 minutes, a winner. I could not believe it. No one around me could fucking believe it. Or screaming,
get in there, Gaffer,
shouting. One of the most brilliant finishes to get, probably the best finish to a game I've been in, I'd say. I've been to some great games, but I've not really seen a finish to a game like that.
Would you say Sammy was head and shoulders above the rest?
Exactly.
Oh. Anyway.
obviously, Zaluska must have been, you know, being on the wee massage on the bench.
Obviously referring to the video that Celtic released this week to promote their charity dinner. To benefit Mary's Meals, a very worthwhile charity and worthwhile cause. But the Celtic players reading off of scripts. I mean, obviously we're not dealing with masters of oratory or public speaking like yourself, Josh. I mean, you know, there were some good outtakes from that. Lukasz Luska obviously speaking in Polish, but they subtitled it in with, you know, Sammy, I want to massage your hair. And then Sammy comes back speaking Greek, like, you can massage my hair anytime. And then, you know, Lassad shows up with, like, a leather jacket, and they you know, edited in some, you know, like a Ned, you know, just went, "Hi, big man, you like my jacket? It's pure brilliant quality, like." Fantastic stuff. I did enjoy that.
Yeah, really, I hope this game just really kind of hammers on the message, you know, approaching the game with confidence and just, you know, try to score goals, because when we got that early goal, we didn't really press that much after. We kind of slacked off a little bit and tried to play too comfortably and, you know, relax.
Well, I think we started to sit back, but also, you know, that link up, I think, and I've picked him out quite a bit today. You know, listen, Kyle was not up to par in many levels today, but Charlie Mulgrew, trying to pick passes, I mean, he, in my opinion, he was as responsible as Forster or Wilson for that second goal. I mean, he can't pick somebody out in a 10-yard pass, loses possession, they get the ball on the break in a very sort of vulnerable place for Celtic. There's all sorts of space open up. And obviously, you have advancing runners coming from the midfield, and there's a lot of space behind our bank of four. And that left, you know, obviously, Wilson and Ambrose exposed, and it set us up for you know, a slack moment, if you will. Now, another, and I hate to focus on the negative, especially in you know, a good result and a good outcome like this, but I mean, look, let's call it how it is, okay? If we would have lost this game 3-2, I'd be talking about these things, so it's important that we don't ignore them. They are issues, you know, all the same. One issue that I haven't touched on today, but I want to get your thoughts on specifically, because I think that you think of things in a very even keeled sort of way, as opposed to me, where I'm just absolutely neurotic about it. But that's Anthony Stokes. I mean, for a player who's playing for a contract at this moment, and much is being made of, you know, is Anthony Stokes worthy of a new contract? You know, are terms, you know, possible with it? Is he part of the Celtics' future, in spite of the fact that he's only 24 years old? But for a player who's playing for a contract, trying to justify it and hammering out the details, he didn't do himself any favors today, did he? I mean, there are a lot of situations where, I mean, his first touch really let him down. He had some opportunities where he really needed to put it past the keeper, and he came up well short. What do you make of that? I mean, I was waiting for him to be substituted, to be honest with you, first, and much, much earlier, because he was off it.
Yeah, from what I've seen, it didn't really look really on form today. But I don't think it was just him, Guy Hooper. I think...
Invisible.
Although he didn't really, you know, have many chances to miss, he didn't really create any chances either.
No.
It was quite invisible. Really, only attacking threats today was Common, Stokes and Hooper. And basically, they were being swept up by the Aberdeen back four. Or back five at times, you know, when Aberdeen players would come, like one of the midfielders would draw back to track Commons.
Yeah.
So what really changed the game is when we brought on Samaras.
I agree.
You know, and we played someone out wide that we could just find the ball up to and get behind the back line. And so many times when Samaras came on, we got behind the back line and we caused them problems. They had to start conceding corners and they couldn't deal with our corners.
Exactly. I mean, so we had wave after wave of corners in the last 10 minutes. I mean, it was one after another. And I mentioned this in the opening. I mean, Aberdeen, in my opinion, I think in a lot of ways they chucked it. I mean, they gave away possession very, very cheaply. And to the credit of the Celtic players on the park at that moment, we made the most of it. Like you said, Sammy doing what he does best, having a ball to run onto, you know, stretching out the defense, like you said, sometimes five at the back. You know, which has caused us problems, packing the box. I mean, we could have put a couple more goals in there, except, I mean, they had the road completely covered. But setting up those corners was absolutely essential. And then for me, I mean, Ambrose has gotten a lot of stick as of late, but I firmly believe Ambrose set up the last two goals. I mean, you know, just by putting a header on the frame, and once that happens and you know, the keeper isn't able to deal with it, anything goes, and we saw the product of it.
Yeah, they're definitely struggling every time we got a corner or free kick. I can't remember who one of the Aberdeen players pulled down. I think it was Guy Hooper. He was getting ready to set up Lassad or Samaras in the box, and you know the Aberdeen player just pulled him back because at that moment, you know, they're starting to struggle, and we just kept on pouncing on it, doing the same thing. Samaras, get behind the defence, cause problems, try to get a shot on goal, and see if we can get a corner, trouble him for the corner, and it worked this game.
Yep.
Where before that, you know, trying to play some nice football and some nice little passes, which was over Aberdeen and just making it easy for Aberdeen to deal with.
Mm.
So once Samaras came on, you know, we made it hard for them and they just crumbled apart.
Yeah, exactly right. Well, and it's nice to have, you know, this sort of result, and especially in the way that it was done. I mean, it was so exciting. I mean, I'm still buzzing, you know, from that finish, you know, going from, you know, such a low to such a high so quickly, and I'm very positive about it. I mean, I recognized and hopefully it's understood that I wanted to put out there as a sort of a both sides of the coin, devil's advocate, if you will, that, you know, yes, you could look at this in terms of, you know, there are things that need to be tightened up, but for me personally, I'm very positive out of this. I think this is really going to springboard us. It's unfortunate that we have a 2-week break now with stupid internationals, but you know, during that time, at least, you know, we have a bit of positivity to spring us on and then bring on San Marino when we come back and hopefully wrap the league up as quickly as possible, get past Dundee United, get to another Hampden final, and then exercise these ghosts and get a couple of pieces of silverware would certainly be handy, Gaffer.
Yeah, definitely. Really, you know, just got to do the same thing as what we did 70 minutes on. In this game, you know, approach games with determination and a clear goal of what we're going to do and use a tactic that works. I think the main problem with our starting lineup today was lack of width.
Mm.
And, you know, Lennon then addressed that and the team made it work.
I think that is as succinctly as you could put it and really sum everything up. Having Commons and Mulgrew out wide is not going to deliver us any width, and it was a major shortcoming for us. Once we brought Samaras on as a wide option, things clicked in. And I keep saying this: I hope that Neil Lennon is learning from this, but you know, we're getting to a certain point where Neil Lennon is not a rookie manager anymore, and he needs to start addressing these things and seeing change and stopping with, you know, the Charlie Mulgrew in the midfield experiment. I don't think it necessarily works, and it certainly doesn't work against every single opponent. The sooner we can get James Forrest back, the better, and hopefully we can start seeing more of Dylan McGeoch, because I think that you know, yes, he's more of a central player. Yes, he doesn't quite have the sort of pace that you would want and expect from a James Forrest, but I think that he's more of a dynamic player out wide, technically with the ball at his feet. Hopefully we can see more of Rogic, and, you know, as we're seeing with how easily James Forrest seems to break down, one of the areas that I hope that we're going to address in the summer transfer window is going to be a winger. You know, somebody with a bit of pace down the flank that can be there to support James Forrest, you know, when and if he does run into injury trouble. I mean, just having one winger as an option, and then Samaras with, you know, sort of the utility floating role that he does, I don't think is quite enough. You know, if Hooper and Wanyama leave, you know, obviously we need to address those positions in certain senses. We'd certainly need a goal-scoring striker. It's not easy to replace 25 goals if Hooper leaves. I don't think that we have the type of player that can replace that sort of productivity. So that needs to be addressed. But a big, big aspect of this Celtic team this season, you know, not just today or in recent weeks, is that lack of pace down the flanks. I think we're relying too much on our fullbacks to deliver that. And when they need to check off our runs, we become far too one-dimensional. And when you're having your forwards up top standing there like statues, you know, it becomes very easy for opposing teams to break it down. So that's my take on it. Gaffer, thanks for joining us. Great work as well on the Beyond the Waves BAMPOP book launch special. If you're listening in, you haven't checked that out, that's on the Hail Hell Media stable of podcasts. Look under Beyond the Waves. I believe it's under BAMPOP book launch special. Where we talk, and Gaffer did a great job producing this, we talked to Paul Arkin, the Green and White writer, about BAMPOP book launches in the past. Gaffer had some excellent insight into his experience, that the development of the character himself, the Gaffer, return of the Gaff, Mark Morrison. Yeah, anyway. So Gaffer had some great insight. We also talked to Sam McLeod and Chaz Duffy, president of the Bronx Boys CSC. So that's a great, great listen. I think it's timeless. It doesn't really have an expiration date. And we looked ahead to the BAMPOP book launch coming up on April 6th at the Celtic Supporters Association on London Road. Sure to be a fantastic time. If you don't have tickets now, you ain't going. But if you do have tickets, I'm sure that you're buzzing for it. It's going to be a fantastic time. Gaffer will be there. So if you see him there, walk up and introduce yourself. Maybe he'll give you a whisper bar or something. So fantastic stuff, Gaffer. Thanks for checking in with us. And we'll speak to you soon.
Yep. Hail, hail, everyone.
Hail, hail to you, Gaffer. Josh Gaffney joining us. A man of wealth and taste. We'll just leave it at that. So, what a week. I mean, there were so many things that we haven't even addressed today, but we got through the technical issues. I think we had a fantastic chat today with Colin Tocchino. Again, I sent out some tweets, and unfortunately, when you try and tweet and podcast at the same time, sometimes it goes pear-shaped. So I had his Twitter address wrong. It's BEDJOSESSIEN, Bedjosian. So check my Twitter feed, BTW Celtic Show. You can get linked up with him. If you're not following Colin Tocchino, please do so. Fantastic insight into African football, not just you know, on the African continent, but gives us a spectacular insight into Victor Wanyama. I mean, really one of the most integral players that's come through Celtic in quite some time, certainly over the past several years. And it's going to be interesting over the next several months to see, you know, what transpires in terms of his career. Is he going to move? Is he not? There's lots of rumors being floated around. And I think Collins has a unique perspective and certainly a lot of credibility as it pertains to that. So hopefully we can have him back real soon. Tweeted out a couple of links. Republicfootball.net, there's a couple of great articles that he's put up there talking about Victor Wanyama. And he has a unique insight into the career path of F.A. Ambrose and where we're going with that. You can also check him out at supersport.com. And great guy, knows his stuff, and great Celtic supporter. So we are very, very thankful for Collins joining us today, giving us some of his time on this Saturday night, and as well as you, the listener. Thank you again for tuning in. was not a thing of beauty, but it was extremely exciting. Certainly at the end there, I had a lot of the English rugby fans in the bar that were waiting for us to vacate, and they can get it right up them. You know, when these people wonder why nobody wants the English football team or whatever to be successful, I mean, the fact that they need to ask, you know, they're so unaware of how just arrogant they are. I mean, if you don't understand and you can't self-reflect, you're never going to understand. So don't even ask me that question. I mean, you know, we were going nuts at the end of the game, and they're, you know, essentially just pushing us out of our own pub that we're there every week. No manners. So I have absolutely no time for them or their teams. And if that offends anybody who's listening, I regret that. But that's just my take. It has nothing to do with my self-identifying Irish heritage. It's some of the behavior is atrocious. Egg chasing. Oh, I kid the rugby fans. So, 4-3, 3 points today. Fantastic stuff. I think we stopped the slide. And onwards and upwards from here, we have an international break over the next couple of weeks. So that's just absolutely gleeful. I hate international breaks. I mean, it's just completely worthless. You know, and I'm sort of disappointed that we can't continue, you know, the result from today as quickly as possible. But fingers crossed that all of our players can go overseas and come back in one piece. No injuries. We've had far too much of that already. So bring everybody back in one piece. We'll go to St. Mirren, and then we'll get the result against Jackie and Simon and Dundee United and onward from there. So for Collins Aquino and the Gaffer and Jerry McMahon and Paulie from Drum Chapel, the absolute Maddie, I'm Graham Wilson. Thanks so much for everybody who joined us today and listened in. And taking us out, as always, is Shane McGowan and the Pogues. Have a wonderful, wonderful St. Patrick's Day tomorrow. Be safe, enjoy, and we'll speak to you soon. Hail, hail, and keep the faith.
The island that is silent now, but the ghosts still haunt the waves, and a torch lights up a famished man who fortune could not save. Did you work upon the railroads? Did you rid the streets of crime? Were your dollars from the White House? Were they from that five and dime? Did the old songs turn to cheer you, and did they still make you cry? Did you count the months and years, or did your teardrops quickly dry? I know for these was not to be, on a cabin ship I came here, and I never even got so far that they could change my name. Thousands are sailing across the Western Ocean to a land of opportunity that some of them will never see. Fortune prevailing across the Western Ocean, their bellies full, their spirits free. They'll break the chain. Dead of afternoon, we stepped hand in hand on Broadway, like the first man on the moon. And a blackbird broke the silence as you whistled it so sweet. And then Brendan Behan's footsteps, I danced up and down the street. And we said goodnight to Broadway, giving it our best regards to the hut, to Mr. Cohen, dear old Times Square's favorite bird. Then we raise a glass to JFK.